quick, put these on and you'll see like a VFX artist.
I already see myself as a bit of a holy chromatic aberration.
Hey, welcome to the world of VFX.
Are these Javez?
If you're creating a sketch based on a video game, it's kind of essential that you include some sort of HUD effect or heads-up display. In this tutorial, we're going to give you the project files and show you how we integrated them into our scene. I'm going to split my heads-up display into several different composite shots to keep things organized. First up is what I'll call the HUD base. I'll create a new composite shot with dimensions to match my footage, and then bring in the top and bottom elements. They're PNGs and they're already transparent, so I don't have to do anything extra. Bring them into your comp, and then if you want, you can animate them to slide in from the edges. This is a simple keyframe of the position property, and I've set the keyframes to custom Bezier so that the animation is a bit smoother. Now I'll create another composite shot for the icons. The reason I'm splitting these up is because I want the blend modes for each composite to be different in the final comp. You can bring in the HUD base composite shot to make things easier as you line up the icons. But remember to hide it in the final, otherwise you'll double up on that element. I'll bring in all the icons and make sure they're lined up and scaled the way I want. And then I'll parent the symbol to the corresponding background. This is so that I can animate the background hexagon and the symbol will grow or shrink with it. For the animation, I did a simple pop-in by keyframing the scale. You'll want to start the scale at 0%. Move forward a couple frames and set it to your final value, then move this keyframe 2 or 3 frames to the right. Plug in your final value and then overshoot it a little bit. Set these keyframes to either smooth or custom. The result of this is that your icon will have a little bit of bounce at the end, which will help the animation look a bit more lively. If you've animated one of the symbols, you can right-click to copy it, then right-click and paste attributes on another layer to paste the animation and save yourself some time. Once those elements have been laid out, we can now look at compositing it into our scene. Here I have my footage already color graded, so I'll start by bringing in the HUD base comp. I'll right-click and set the blend to overlay. Then I'll use a tint effect to set the white colors to a more light blue. To make it glow, I'll use the LightSword Ultra Glow Only effect. If you're using Express, you can use either the regular glow and change the per channel intensity controls, or purchase the VFX Neon Lights pack. I'll change both the inner and outer glow to a blue color, and adjust the properties so that there's a nice falloff and it's not too intense. Finally, I'll add some radial blur and chromatic aberration to make it a little bit more imperfect. For the HUD icons comp, I'll do basically the same thing, but I'll set the blend to screen. This makes them a bit more obvious in the shot. I'll also add either a gleam or auto volumetrics effect to give them some light streaks. Now you'll notice that the background is currently too bright. You can't really see the elements. To fix this, we're going to create a new grade layer and set it below the icons and the base. Onto this grade, I'll add a blur effect and then use Exposure Pro to darken the footage down. You don't have to use Exposure Pro to darken the footage. If you're in Express, you can use pretty much anything. Curves, brightness and contrast, the regular exposure effect. All you're doing is darkening the footage. Finally, I'll mask out the areas behind the HUD element so that it doesn't affect the whole scene. It's a little bit more readable, but it's still quite bright. I'll create a new plane layer and leave it as black. I'll drag it below everything else and then use the rectangular mask tool to create a mask so that it's sort of a vignette around the scene. Be sure to feather it in the controls panel. I'll duplicate this layer, add a fill color effect, and set it to blue. Then change the blend to overlay. This gives the edges a blue tint as seen in the actual movie. Now that we've got the HUD overlaid, we can look at adding some elements into our world, and to do that, the first thing we need to do is motion track the scene. For this, I'll use Foundry Camera Tracker, but it doesn't necessarily have to be a 3D track. You can use a point tracker, but you might have to do it for each individual element, depending on where you want to place it in the scene. The camera tracker takes care of that all at once. I'll just make sure to set the track validation from free camera to rotating camera, since I wasn't moving forward or sideways in the scene. I'm just standing still rotating the camera. If you're unfamiliar with how to use the camera tracker, check out our previous tutorial on how to do just that. Once we have our footage tracked, we can start adding things into our world. I did a little bit of sky replacement by adding in an image of clouds and setting the blend to overlay. This makes it a bit more natural. I then threw on and keyframed a mosaic effect to make it look like the image was loading into the scene like it would in a video game. Since we're seeing the world through the eyes of the VFX artist, I thought it'd be cool to add in some visual tracking markers. To do this, I first created a 50x50 composite shot, very small, and typed the letter X. This is going to be the texture that we'll use in the particles. Bring this X comp into the main comp. I'll add a particle simulator and set the shape to quad. Because this effect is 3D and we've motion tracked our scene, we don't need to attach it to any points. I'll change the shape to quad so that the particles spawn in a rectangular shape. I'll extend the life of the particles, then change the texture source to layer and select the X composite. Scale the particles up or down as needed. Select the particle system, then open the lifetime panel. In the color properties, change the type to gradient, and then add markers for red, yellow, and green. This means that over each individual particle's lifetime, they'll start as the color red, shift to yellow halfway through, and then change to green. I also ended up adding a neon line that says planar tracking surface because those are the things we look for when we're on set. For this, I used a plane that I set to 3D, and then drew a mask around the outline of the building. I can then add the neon path effect and keyframe the extension property to have it grow in. You'll want to change the blend of this plane to either add or screen. If you're interested in knowing how we created the hologram effects, we'll be covering that next week, so be sure to subscribe and ring the bell if you haven't already. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next video.